Dungeons & Dragons might just be the single most prominent outside influence on video games. While the iconography of popular 80s movies and certain fantasy authors was undeniably important for the budding video game industry, none of them influenced video games mechanically the way D&D did. They both came to be at around the same time, and when the medium was still young, there was a strong overlap between PC gamers and role players. While the tabletop RPG became less relevant for the burgeoning video game industry as consumer hardware became more powerful and production values got better, some elements of D&D have persisted in the common DNA of RPGs throughout the ages. One such example is the proliferation of sewer levels, which are a popular trope in RPGs regardless of the setting. You can trace the origin of this weird obsession with waste disposal systems back to D&D. Sewer networks consist of long, identical-looking hallways, so they provide a logical context for dungeons. It's not hard to figure out the connection between that and a game called Dungeons & Dragons. At its core, D&D is about a group of players forming a party to explore dungeons in hopes of finding treasure. The player who is the dungeon master is in charge of making the dungeon appropriately challenging. Most of early computer RPGs were derivative of D&D and tried to convert the experience into the video game format as closely as they could. But they had to make concessions to account for the lack of unlimited interactivity and player freedom that the pen and paper format allows. Thus, navigating through maze-like dungeons played a big part in the challenge of many RPGs developed in the 80s. Even though Western and Eastern RPGs alike started dramatically scaling down the challenge and complexity of dungeon layouts when the genre became more popular in the early 90s, the idea of using branching dungeons as a test of endurance has persisted to this day. The influence that D&D had on level design isn't limited to just RPGs. Austin Grossman cites a module called Tomb of Horrors as an inspiration for a level in Ultima Underworld 2. That he used as a mini prototype for System Shock.
I remember one where there was a kind of, that was kind of modeled on a Tomb of Horrors, where there was a series of sort of undead liches. And that was the one I was most, I was proudest of, that I felt like I had the most voice in. It was in some way like a mini prototype for System Shock.
Doom also has considerably more maze-like levels than modern FPS games, as both John Romero and Sandy Peterson had a background in being dungeon masters. In fact, all of the founding members of id Software played D&D, while the older Peterson designed pen and paper RPGs before he became involved with the video game industry. It wasn't unheard of for first-generation game developers to have a background in designing pen and paper RPGs or tabletop war games. Even beyond that, D&D was very ubiquitous amongst American game developers of the 70s, 80s, and even 90s, so it could have influenced the design of countless games on a subconscious level. After all, Dungeons & Dragons established the entire framework for RPGs as a genre, as it was the first commercially released pen and paper RPG. Central mechanics and core gameplay concepts like classes, hit points, character creation, alignments, basing combat on statistical probabilities, and governing the gameplay with an overarching rule set are all examples of things we take for granted that were either invented or popularized by Dungeons & Dragons. You could even make the claim that it set in stone how designers collectively approach RPGs in a video game context. The first video games in the RPG genre were straightforward D&D replications. A few years later, the first commercial RPGs were released, most notable of which were Wizardry and Ultima. They still drew heavy inspiration from D&D, while incorporating some ideas of their own into the mix. Even then, Wizardry is more or less a copy of an earlier D&D-inspired game called Oubliette, while Ultima creator Richard Garriott honed his programming skills in the 70s by making 28 D&D-based games for his leisure, after which he applied the skills he had learned to making the first Ultima games. It's harder to gauge to what extent D&D influenced JRPGs, due to the language barrier and the fact that archiving the history and timeline of Japanese PC games has been purely left in the hands of hobbyists. Although the game never reached similar widespread popularity in the East, it was localized in 1985 along with Wizardry and Ultima. But even before that, some enthusiasts had imported copies of Dungeons & Dragons and Western computer RPGs to the country. The seminal Dragon Quest was an amalgamation of Wizardry and Ultima. Though it simplified the interface for consoles, while it is the mother of the JRPG genre, it's not the first Japanese RPG by a long shot, and neither was the wizardry-inspired Black Onyx, which was released 2 years earlier in 1984. Even before that, there were at least 15 RPGs released for NEC computers, among them a few localized Western games like Telengard, which itself is a recreation of an older game called D&D. I can't say anything about the content and design influence of those games, but I think it's safe to say that D&D still had a significant impact on early Japanese RPGs, even if by proxy through early Western RPGs. Take alignments, for example. D&D categorizes characters into 9 different alignments, which tells us whether they are good, neutral, or evil, and whether they follow a lawful, neutral, or a chaotic philosophy. So there are different forms of good and evil. But the first edition of D&D only had 3 alignments, lawful, chaotic, and neutral. Wizardry used a similar system in character creation, but with good and evil replacing lawful and chaotic. The series was immensely popular and influential among Japanese gamers and game developers, so it's not surprising that both the Shin Megami Tensei series and Ogre Battle series feature alignment systems, as they include moral choices and branching. Another more interesting artifact of D&D's long-term influence can be found in The Dark Spire. It's a Japanese dungeon crawler from 2008 that's deliberately as old-school as possible. It closely mimics wizardry, and thus it uses a similar counterintuitive armor system that's derived from Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, where a negative armor score equals a higher defense. As time went on, Japanese RPGs started diverging more from Western RPGs as the popularity of CRPGs waned in Japan, so many of the more advanced gameplay mechanics seen in later Western RPGs never caught on in JRPGs. The first known computer RPGs were on a PLATO computer system at the University of Illinois in 1975, a year after D&D's initial release, when the game had only sold about 4,000 copies. PLATO and similar research computers had a lot of software that was decades ahead of its time, and games were no exception. Email, online chat, touchscreens, screen sharing, and online gaming are just some examples of things that PLATO did years before anyone else. Maze War is a rudimentary first-person shooter from 1974 that implemented networked multiplayer deathmatch almost 2 decades before Doom. Other early online games included Empire from the same year, which is a multiplayer arena shooter that can have up to 30 simultaneous players, while Spasm, which is also from 74, did the same thing in 3D. Although the game world was divided into 4 planetary systems that could each have up to 8 players on them at once, Avatar from 78 had up to 60 simultaneous players and is one of the earliest MUDs, a precursor to MMORPGs. It's also likely the first game where players got to distribute their own stats. So even before the Fairchild F, Atari 2600, and Odyssey 2 were released, ambitious and groundbreaking games were being developed on campus computers by university students. Among them, dungeon crawlers were a popular genre. Pedit 5 is credited as the first one, though predated by a game called M199H that was deleted. In it, the player creates a character by rolling dice, enters a dungeon to kill monsters and find treasure. Pedit was followed by D&D, whose creators had played Pedit and wanted to improve upon it. It starts similarly, by you creating a character whose stats are randomized by a dice roll. Battles are simple exchanges where you either die, or defeat your foe and get a message proclaiming your victory. Orthanc is an almost identical game, though it has an automap function that fills as you explore the area. If you get enough experience points, you can get your name in the Hall of Fame, where different universities are represented. Moria was also released in 1975. It's notable for being the first RPG that wasn't inspired by D&D. The developers hadn't even heard of D&D when they started the project, but were in contact with the creators of the D&D Plato game during development. Moria differs from Pedit and its offspring mechanically. Instead of stats being determined by dice rolls, you get to pick out of 4 different options what kind of attributes you want your character to have, which is effectively the same as selecting a class. Exploration is done from a first-person perspective, so wizardry and other dungeon crawlers can trace their lineage back to this game, while Ultima uses the same style as Pedit 5, D&D, and Ornthank. On top of being the forefather of classic dungeon crawlers, Moria's innovations aren't limited to just changing the camera angle. It was the first RPG to do many things. Characters age, and you must consume food and water like in the Ultima games. Weapons have offensive and defensive ratings, while spells are divided to mage and priest spells. There are secret doors like in Wizardry, stats increase with use, and the maximum isn't 18 like in D&D-based games. You can increase them up to 100 like in Wizardry. You can set up a camp where you can store excess items, while storekeepers can make suggestions to you based on how much money you have to spend. You can tie a string to a location and automatically return there, which is a feature that some later dungeon crawlers, like Etrian Odyssey, use to reduce backtracking. However, the most impressive feature is that up to 10 players can play together in a group, and there are even guilds. 2 years later, Oubliette was released. It took a lot of inspiration from Moria, and greatly influenced the developers of Wizardry. It's another incredibly advanced game for its era. It would take years and years before regular home computer games reached a similar level of sophistication. Now, character creation allowed players to choose from 15 different races and classes. Once you've created a character, you're supposed to head down to a tavern to form a party with other players, as the game was designed for multiplayer. For that reason, there's an in-game chat command that lets you write messages to others. If you really want to read more about this game and how it influenced Wizardry, check out the CRPG Addict's blog. His site is a goldmine for those interested in the history of Western RPGs. If you want to try these games for yourself, head to cyberone.org, download PTERM, and apply for an account. It took a while for an official D&D video game adaptation to emerge after these trailblazing PLATO games set the stage. The first licensed D&D games were actually released for consoles, more specifically, the Intellivision, Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, which was later titled Cloudy Mountain, and Treasure of Tarmin, were released in 82 and 83 exclusively for the Intellivision in North America. Cloudy Mountain is a very rudimentary action-adventure, although quite advanced when compared to other second-generation console games. The control scheme is quite convoluted, but what the game boils down to is killing monsters and finding items. You've got a bow with a limited amount of arrows, which you can use to kill enemies. They even ricochet from corners, so they can be used to kill enemies without drawing them to you. Once you find a key, an axe, and a boat, you can reach new areas on the world map as you try to reach Cloudy Mountain and obtain the Crown of Kings. Treasure of Tarmin is a more true RPG, and if it weren't for Dragon Stomper, it would be the first console RPG ever released. It's more complex than its predecessor, and probably the deepest game on the system. The entire controller is used for different functions, like opening doors, picking up items, and glancing left or right. It's technically also very impressive, featuring three-dimensional first-person dungeon crawling 5 years before Phantasy Star. This time around, battles are turn-based, and your goal is to descend to the bottom of a huge dungeon, kill a minotaur, and steal his treasure. The game world consists of mazes that are connected in the shape of a reverse pyramid. You can bring up a map to see where you are, but if you want to know where you are within individual levels, you'll have to map them by hand. It's not an enjoyable or interesting game experience these days, but for the Intellivision, Treasure of Tarmin is very impressive. For some reason, it took 5 years before another licensed D&D game was developed. I haven't found out the reason why game developers didn't get the rights earlier, but it took until 1987 for Strategic Simulations to acquire the rights to develop games using the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons license. After they released Pool of Radiance in 1988, the words SSI and D&D became synonymous for years, as the company released over 30 D&D games between 88 and 95. SSI was founded by Joel Billings in 1979. Joel was a wargaming enthusiast, so it should come as no surprise that they made a name for themselves developing strategy and simulation games, particularly one set in the World War II time period. In the mid-80s, they started developing RPGs like the Fantasy series and Wizard's Crown, which is one of the first tactical RPGs. It uses a top-down perspective to incorporate movement and positioning into turn-based battles. This influenced the development of Pool of Radiance a lot. Pool of Radiance is one of the most important RPGs of all time. It was so popular that it spawned an entire line of RPGs called the Goldbox series, as all of the games came in golden boxes. The Pool of Radiance engine ended up being used in 11 D&D games, including the first graphical MMORPG, as well as in two sci-fi RPGs. After the series had run its course, SSI released Forgotten Realms Unlimited Adventures in 93, which is an RPG construction kit that lets players create their own gold box adventures. Adventure Construction Set and even the first Japanese edition of RPG Maker predate the game, so it's not the first of its kind, but you could still see it as one of the first games developed with user-created content in mind. For a game to spawn two groundbreaking spin-off titles and eight sequels in the time span of 5 years, it must have done something right. For essentially being the first proper D&D video game, Pool of Radiance did a lot of things right. Although it's down to personal preference, you could easily make the case for it being the best RPG released before the 90s. What makes this such an outstanding game is how advanced it is for being such an early title. While contemporary games such as Starflight and Ultima 5 had amazingly complex and advanced gameplay mechanics and writing, Pool of Radiance's chief accomplishment is how well it balances relatively deep mechanics with fun gameplay and functional UI. While it took a while for me to get accustomed to the UI, I can personally vouch that the Goldbox games are still enjoyable to play, even for newcomers. In fact, they're easily some of the most well-aged RPGs from the 80s. However, it's worth noting that later Goldbox titles added a new feature that makes them a bit easier to get into, which is why I'll mostly use footage from Champions of Kryn in this video. In Pool of Radiance, you have to manually cast healing spells to replenish health when you're resting, whereas later games automated this process. It removed a lot of tedious repetition from the gameplay. But let's back up a bit and see how the game starts before delving into the more technical details. All of the games start with party creation. Unlike in JRPGs, or even modern Western RPGs, you don't play just one character and recruit more people to your party along the way. You must instead create your own party by assembling six different characters, which you must name. It's standard practice in computer RPGs, but it's worth noting that you don't play as predefined characters like Commander Shepard, Geralt, or Adam Jensen in these games. When choosing a class, you can also opt out for dual or multi-classing. One character can even have three different professions at once. It's a common feature in D&D games, and generally there aren't any negative trade-offs beyond slower leveling and making a hybrid character. Once you've chosen the sex, race, and class of your character, you must choose an alignment. In most D&D video games, it actually doesn't affect anything, but it's still always a part of the character creation process. That kind of cargo cult programming isn't conducive to good game design, but it's understandable as many early RPG developers considered making an exact recreation of tabletop D&D the highest goal in game development. Similarly, some race-class combinations are useless due to the pen and paper rules. Halflings have a lower strength cap and their fighters can only reach the 6th level, while human fighters can level up unlimitedly, and females of all races have a lower maximum strength than their male counterparts. So it just doesn't make any sense to make a halfling fighter, especially one that's female, even if you're given the choice to do so. Another similarly puzzling carryover from tabletop gaming is the rolling of virtual dice for stats. It's something you have to get used to, as D&D games did that until the turn of the millennium. In the early rule editions of the tabletop game, you might get a bad roll and end up with a dumb mage or a scrawny fighter, but in the video games, you can re-roll your stats as many times as you want until you get the desired outcome. So all this tabletop simulation accomplishes is making players waste a lot of time trying to get an optimal character by repeatedly re-rolling their stats. What kind of stats you roll is actually really crucial, as your base stats don't go up every time you level like in many other RPGs. While your hit points, hit chance, and saving throws get better with each level, there isn't much power creep in Pool of Radiance and other similar D&D titles. A fighter who starts out with 25 hit points might have 100 by the end of the game. Similarly, the health of monsters and bosses isn't bloated to absurd proportions. D&D's health system still has unrealistic implications when compared to the tabletop war games that it was inspired by, but having your health triple or quadruple within a single playthrough is still tame when compared with more loot-centric RPGs, where stats are inflated to the point of a single increase feeling meaningless. A unique part of the Gold Box character creation process is crafting your own character's portraits and sprites. Of course, everyone who has ever played this game has had a laugh by combining unfitting male and female parts together. This feature was scrapped from the sequels, but they retain the sprite creation process, as it actually affects gameplay. You can choose different body parts and color combinations to make your characters look distinct from one another, which is really helpful in combat, as it makes it easier to visualize how your characters are positioned on the map. When you fine-tuned your party, you can transfer your characters from one game to another, even between games that aren't part of the Gold Box series. That's because the series is kind of divided into three trilogies. Four are set in the standard Forgotten Realms setting. The Kryn trilogy, which this video showcases, uses the Dragonlance setting, which features more draconoid creatures and undead, while two games use the Savage Frontier setting. Their development was outsourced to a developer called Stormfront Studios, which is something that SSI did a lot to keep up with the demand. Once you've assembled a party, you can start exploring the game world. The game plays from a first-person perspective while you're in towns, but switches to a top-down view once you run into a random battle. So it's a Dragon Warrior-esque mix of Ultima and Wizardry, except the influences are mixed up the other way around. The graphics aren't good enough that you could easily tell the areas apart from one another, so you'll likely have to map down some areas by hand to a graph paper or an Excel sheet. You learn the layout of cities over time, but getting lost in a dungeon is a real threat. Thus, mapping out towns and dungeons by hand is going to eat up some time and paper when you play these games. But dungeon exploration is downplayed and tame when compared with actual dungeon crawlers of this era, which were filled with teleporters, traps, and other mechanics like that which were actively trying to make the process of navigating and mapping the dungeon more challenging. Admittedly, navigating cities isn't the easiest task in this game, if you are used to automatic, high-quality maps in modern RPGs, but the interface always tells you which direction you're facing and at what coordinate you're standing at, which makes it easier to keep track of where you are. There's even an in-game map, which is a technically impressive feature for an 8-bit RPG to have, but it only shows the layout of the room without any kind of atlas, so it isn't really enough to go by. But at least this feature lets you move around while staring at the map. So all in all, the developers did a lot to help players from feeling lost, given the technical limitations they had to work with. Combat is where the game really shines. For the longest time, the Gold Box games were considered to have the best battle system out of any RPG. Battles are turn-based, and they incorporate both grid-based movement and inventory management into the mix. You can move your characters around on the battlefield, and positioning plays an important role in battles. Rogues can backstab enemies for extra damage. Equipped shields don't protect against attacks made from the side or back. You can't use ranged weapons if there's an enemy standing in an adjacent grid, and there's friendly fire, so you must be careful not to throw area effect spells in areas where they might affect your party members. Line of sight affects spells and arrows, which you can use to your advantage by hiding vulnerable characters behind terrain. While all these features might sound obvious, you'll have to keep in mind that having things like line of sight affect gameplay weren't a given in RPGs back then. And even far after the game's release, many games were, and are, content not bothering about adding such details to add depth to the gameplay. But there's still a few more novel and exclusive mechanics that the Gold Box games featured. When a character's health drops to zero, they don't automatically die. They'll become unconscious, as long as the killing blow didn't exceed negative 10 hit points. After that, an unconscious character starts bleeding to death, so one character has to spend a turn bandaging them to prevent them from dying. However, this mechanic does not require you to walk next to the injured person to heal them, which is a missed opportunity to further emphasize the importance of positioning. At least attacks of opportunity play a very prominent role in how you maneuver around the battlefield. If you try to move when standing next to an enemy, it will momentarily interrupt your turn to perform an automatic attack. This goes both ways. It makes protecting your spellcasters extremely important, because if they get surrounded even by just one enemy fighter, they might get struck dead just by attempting to back up from that situation. Some enemy types also affect your positioning. Certain draconian enemies explode upon dying, damaging everyone around them, which can cause a chain reaction. Others turn into stone, which can temporarily disarm your melee fighters as their weapons get stuck. Snakes can poison you, which is a big deal in this game, so you want to keep your distance and try to kill them with spells and arrows. and undead enemies can drain your level, which I found out the hard way. And as it's a real RPG, characters' stats also influence their movement. Dexterity increases initiative, which determines who'll get to move first, while strength affects your ability to carry items. The heavier your armor and inventory load, the less grids you can move on your turn. A strong character can carry more items and thus move farther away than a weak character, who becomes encumbered by that same load of items. Speaking of inventory, you can access it during combat. You can use consumables or change your armor and weapons in the middle of battle. Most often, you'll use this to switch between your ranged and melee weapons. As bows and slings have a very important function in these games, spellcasting isn't instantaneous. So when an enemy starts casting a spell, you can try to interrupt it by shooting an arrow at it, if said enemy is far away or covering behind fighters. Certain spells like Hold Person, Sleep, and Stinking Cloud can incapacitate enemies. Incapacitated enemies die from just one hit, so while your hard-hitting warriors are swinging swords at the front lines, you can change the weapon of your mage or cleric from a staff to darts and score instant kills by throwing them at sleeping enemies. Spellcasting differs quite a lot from modern RPGs. Mages aren't long-distance damage dealers that constantly bombard enemies with spells. While later on they could learn how to cast fireballs and lightning bolts, it's their disruptive utility spells that makes them valuable, while warriors deal the bulk of the damage. A single magic missile deals a pitiful amount of damage, and you can only cast a few of them at lower levels before you have to rest. In fact, at low levels, mages are almost useless, as beyond casting a few spells, they can't really do anything. But they become more and more useful as they level up. That's how magic works in D&D. As there is no mana that you can replenish, you can memorize a set amount of spells, which you are able to cast after sleeping. While that encourages you to spend your spells carefully, it's also one of the mechanics that doesn't quite make sense in a video game context. If you unexpectedly run into a dragon boss, you'll likely get incinerated. So you'll load a save, memorize protection from fire, buff your party with all possible protective spells, and then step in the door. Not being able to react to new challenges and improvised strategies diminishes the tactical depth of the game, but that's how these games work. Players can adjust the difficulty of the experience by regulating how often they rest. When you rest in a dungeon, you might get ambushed, but you still have the option to take your time and replenish your resources that way as much as you want. Anyhow, spells are divided into different levels. You can gain more spell slots the higher your level becomes. So whereas you might only be able to cast 2 level 1 spells when you start the game, by level 5 you can cast 4 level 1 spells, 2 level 2 spells, and 1 level 3 spell. Even fighters don't start off as all-powerful killing machines, especially at low levels. You will miss more than you'll hit. Sometimes, it can take minutes to kill just one enemy. It's ridiculous. That's the thing about this game. It's not built for instant gratification. It's a slow burn. But when you stick with it and see your characters grow from weaklings to almost killing a dragon with just one hit, it's very satisfying. Over time, fighters will gain additional attacks, cleave, which makes them automatically hit the next enemy if they deal a killing blow, and their attack accuracy will go up as well. That's how D&D is balanced. At low levels, the combat is more unpredictable, while your damage output becomes more stable later on due to the way dice probabilities work. That's why fans of the genre tend to specify low and high level D&D from each other. If you don't like the former, you can play one of the sequels where you start off as a high level character. While the battles are genuinely engaging and deeper than in many modern RPGs, they can start to feel drawn out and tedious due to missed hits and a laborious control scheme. The UI is user-friendly thanks to these on-screen verb prompts, but aiming your attacks, moving items from one person to another, and memorizing spells can all feel more like work than they should. That's because the game was developed for the Commodore 64, which didn't really use the mouse. Pointing and clicking would have made performing many of the tasks easier, but as it is, you interact with your keyboard quite a lot. There actually is a quick combat option that will automatically solve battles for you, but that can mess with your resource management, and it doesn't remove the tedium of manually selecting to attack targets in hard battles, where you can't put the game on autopilot. For the most part, combat works fine using the arrow keys, but you have to use the target key and then select the target if you want to attack diagonally.
The later games fixed this problem by automatically targeting the nearest enemy when you use the aim command. The UI isn't really all that hard to get into. It's the mapping process and note-taking that will be the larger culture shock for those used to modern RPGs. There is no journal feature, so every time you have an important conversation, it's a good idea to write down where to go and what to do. Another technical inconvenience is the fact that much of the storyline must be read from the manual, as the developers had to save disk space by doing so. Every now and then the game prompts you to read Journal Entry 11 or Bar Tale 5, which you must look up from the journal. It was common back then for manuals to contain information that couldn't be fit inside the game, as doing tutorials and things like that was unfeasible with such memory limitations.
The realism of it, and realizing that we could make a cool decision and change the medium, because I could feel that this worked in a way that things hadn't worked before in the medium, despite the fact that I ripped it off from Pool of Radiance.
Goldbox Games effectively tell most of their storylines through these journal entries, which are numbered so that you can't just read the entire storyline in advance. Wasteland actually featured an alternate storyline about a Martian invasion in its manual, which never happens in the real game. That's one way to fool players who try to cheat. You also have to check the damage values for weapons from the manual, which is unfortunate but understandable. And since you can't name your save files, you must be cautious and not get them mixed together. Generally speaking, in old PC games, it's a good idea to have multiple save files. One save file for cities, and a few temporary saves that you can alternate between when you're exploring the dungeons and other dangerous areas, when there's a risk that you might get permanently stuck if your party gets wiped out. Pool of Radiance isn't an easy game to get into these days, but I retain that the learning curve to depth and enjoyability ratio is really good. All the mechanical advancements the developers made make sense, and most of them are intuitive to understand rather than some complex rules that would just make the experience more obtuse. But I still recommend the sequels over the original, as they added some new classes and races to character creation, improved the graphics, and more importantly, streamlined the resting process. They also have a less annoying form of copy protection. The first game uses a device called the Code Wheel, which you have to use every time the game boots up. As if that wasn't enough, every time you die you have to reboot the game and do it again. SSI quickly moved away from this model to just forcing the players to look up some random word from the manual. Audio-visually, the game is decent. The DOS version hasn't got any music, so you can just listen to music or podcasts without subjecting your ears to ear-grating 80s DOS tunes. The sound effects are quite sparse, and they aren't bad. The graphics aren't mind-blowing, but better than in Ultima or Wizardry. It may not look like much now, but back in 88, the Goldbox games marked a new era for RPG development as they included dedicated artists. You can easily tell what's going on in battles, and the occasional story segments featured some really good 8-bit pixel art. But as I've mentioned before, moving in towns and dungeons can be somewhat disorienting due to lack of details that would help separate similar-looking hallways and doors from each other. Sometimes you even have to search those identical-looking corners of the dungeon for secrets. But honestly, you'd be surprised how quickly moving through areas you've previously visited becomes instinctive. There are a few features I failed to mention so far that are worth mentioning. You can try to negotiate with some enemies, you can try a haughty, sly, meek, nice, or abusive tone of voice. In some areas you can come across NPCs that might join your party, at least temporarily, and some of them might betray you. The way the game treats loot is different from many RPGs. Generally in D&D games, if you kill a soldier who wears plate armor and a sword, you'll find a plate armor and a sword from the loot. If you kill 5 similar enemies, they'll all drop the same stuff. You can't pick up every single weapon dropped by enemies, otherwise you'll become encumbered in no time, and most simple weapons will only sell for a few gold coins anyhow. In Goldbox games, this also applies to money. Coins have a weight, and you can carry a limited amount of them around with you, so every time you get loot, you're asked how many coins you want to take, which can be annoying. Unless you buy something expensive, at some point you'll have to deposit some of your valuables that you're carrying around with you in the bank. And instead of a universal currency like gold coins, there are multiple currencies. Mages mostly learn new spells by copying them from magic scrolls. so it isn't always guaranteed that you'll learn certain spells. You can try to open locked doors by making the rogue lockpick it, fighter force it, or a mage cast a knock spell on it. I'm sure I'm missing and overlooking some little details that give these games more depth and character, like the Moon System and Night Quest in Champions of Kryn, but I think I've made it reasonably clear how sophisticated these games are despite their shortcomings. It's absolutely shameful how little fanfare there is surrounding the Gold Box titles these games, even among fans of RPGs. Not only is the series one of the cornerstones of Western RPGs, but Pool of Radiance also brought more new things to the table than many other old RPGs that are now considered classics that every self-respecting fan of the genre has to try. If you decide to give one of these games a chance, remember to set up the config file. Otherwise, you might not be able to save your characters and start a new game. Although Pool of Radiance was ported to the NES, it's recommended that you play one of the computer versions. The console versions of Western RPGs were often scaled down, simplified, censored, or otherwise different from their PC counterparts. While D&D games of the 80s and 90s were primarily developed for MS-DOS and other computers, they have some console-exclusive games as well. There's at least one gem among them, and that is Order of the Griffon from Westwood Studios. It's a stellar tactical RPG that was only released for the TurboGrafx-16. I covered this game on my video on underrated tactical RPGs, so I'll just rehash and summarize that mini-review here. The game uses first edition rules where different races act as classes, and there is no character creation, as you can only choose 4 pre-made characters of your liking to your party. So while it's slightly dumbed down in comparison, it still offers a good Gold Box-esque experience, combining first-person dungeon crawling with tactical turn-based combat. The gameplay is really similar, while the graphics are a lot better, which makes navigating towns easier. While those who've already played the Gold Box games might find this game a bit lacking, it offers good training wheels for those who are intimidated of jumping straight into Pool of Radiance. Even beyond that, it's just really good for being a Western RPG on a 16-bit console. You can count the good ones on one hand. Westwood also released Warriors of the Eternal Sun for the Mega Drive that same year. I don't own it, so I can't comment on whether it's any good or not, but it looks really similar to Order of the Griffon. While the Gold Box RPGs were the lifeline of SSI between 88 and 92, it also tried complementing those releases with other D&D games that offered different takes on the IP, to appeal to both action and strategy gamers. Earliest examples was the launch of the Silver Box series, a line of action RPGs by US Gold. First of them was Heroes of the Lance, a clunky side-scroller so bad that it's already been torn to shreds in an AVGN-style review eons ago. The sequel, Dragons of Flame, wasn't much better. These games are a complete waste of time and the license. Westwood's Hillsfar is an interesting take on the genre. You play a single character in what is essentially a glorified minigame collection. You can ride a horse, fight on an arena, and play an arcing shooting gallery. Towns and caves are explored from the first-person perspective, while the game switches to an over-the-head view when you enter buildings. Something that would have really benefited the Gold Box games is this large map that makes navigating the city easier. But the most notable feature of Hillsfar is the in-depth lockpicking minigame. War of the Lance combined SSI strategy expertise with D&D, and is one of the better spin-off titles. The game is divided into 3 phases, moving forces around on the map, having heroes retrieve magic items, and establishing diplomatic contacts. It's a strategy game rather than a tactics game, so I don't really like it, but the graphics are clear and the UI is sensible, so I'm sure that those more fond of the genre will find enjoyment from this title.
DragonStrike is another title that takes place on Kryn. It combines the flight simulation genre with a fantasy theme. In it, you play as a dragon rider armed with a lance, whose goal is to clear levels of flying enemies. You can occasionally breathe fire and claw enemies below you. It's not purely a mindless action game. You have to observe the situation and think what angle you'll use to approach enemies. Given the release year and the fact that it uses fractal 3D landscapes, the action is fairly smooth. The game was ported to the NES and even the X68000 in Japan, despite its relative obscurity. The NES version obviously couldn't handle 3D graphics, so it was converted to a free-roaming top-down shooter. Shadow Sorcerer is another attempt by US Gold to make an action-y D&D game, and it does a far better job than the previous tries. In it, you control a group of pre-made characters who are running away with a group of rescued slaves from a pursuing dragon army. While exploring the world map, you occasionally see descriptions of the area or get prompted to read the journal. Like in Goldbox games, this makes it easier to get invested in the adventure, even if you have to use your imagination. But the interesting part is the combat. It happens in real time, but is paused when you issue orders, making it a premonition of things to come. Unfortunately, moving around units is slow and imprecise, but it's still a marked improvement on Heroes of the Lance.
Eye of the Beholder had a large impact on dungeon crawlers in the early 90s, and it was popular enough to get two sequels. It's like any old dungeon crawler with party creation, grid-based movement, and a first-person perspective, except that the combat happens in real time, and there's a large focus on different kinds of switch and pressure plate puzzles. If you've played Legend of Grimrock, you've played Eye of the Beholder. Actually, this game didn't even invent real-time dungeon crawling. The seminal Dungeons of Daggerwrath had real-time combat back in 1982, and Eye of the Beholder itself is mostly a D&D reskin of Dungeon Master, which came out 3 years earlier. As for the gameplay, you control the entire party in real-time by using a point-and-click-based interface. By clicking the weapon of your character, you use it, and each has a cooldown period, so you must alternate between characters. The problem with this system is that spellcasting is very cumbersome, and your back row characters can often be useless. Although you can throw objects, there just isn't much depth to battles beyond kiting and mashing your front row fighter's attack button. It's a massive step backwards from the Goldbox games. While the battles could occasionally be drawn out in them, here the real-time combat isn't visceral enough to be satisfying like an action game, but it's fast enough that you haven't got time to think through your actions, as you're stuck using the mouse for actions. Controlling an entire party in real-time just wasn't a feasible thing to implement with the hardware limitations of the time. So instead they scaled back and dumbed down the combat in an attempt to make it more smooth and manageable. That's actually a really annoying feature of Amiga-era dungeon crawlers. They were so enamored with the concept of mouse-driven UI that they didn't give players the option for using keyboard shortcuts for anything. While this simplification made the genre more accessible when compared to some older titles that used half the keyboard for mundane actions, these point-and-click-driven UIs are awful for real-time combat, where you have to control multiple characters at once. This trend of real-time dungeon crawlers was partially responsible for causing a dark age period for CRPGs. But this doesn't mean that nothing good came out of these games. Eye of the Beholder is still a classic dungeon crawler with sound and graphics that were really good for the time. And monsters are also well detailed and animated. Interestingly, the Sega CD version has, in addition to a voiced intro, a new soundtrack, which is composed by Yuzi Koshiro. I wouldn't recommend this version, though, unless you've got a Sega-compatible mouse. Otherwise, moving is a pain, as you have to do it by clicking. Dungeon Hack combined Eye of the Beholder with the roguelike genre, and it did it 3 years before Diablo was released. Instead of a party, you just created one character to explore randomly generated dungeons.
It works quite well as a time waster. Since you're only controlling one character, you can easily jump in and out of game sessions due to the disposable nature of procedural generation. After the Eye of the Beholder engine ran its course, SSI released DreamForge Entertainment's Ravenloft, Strahd's Possession, which was quickly followed by Menzoberranzan and Stone Prophet. These games moved the real-time gameplay from dungeons to outdoor areas, and shrunk down the initial party to just two characters. The advent of CDs allowed for voiced intros and more atmospheric music, and the visuals are a big step up from the later Goldbox titles. However, the real-time combat is yet again lacking in depth, devolving the intricate tactics of party-based combat to feverish clicking and occasional spellcasting. It's a shame, as for that reason, I just feel bored by the gameplay of these titles. Everything else looks nice, though. Movement can be kind of slippery, as if you were playing Doom and the 3D graphics can be grainy, but the dark settings and good visuals make it seem like there's potential if you just stick with these games. Al-qadim is one of those handful of single-character action RPGs with a top-down view that predate Diablo. It's a more beginner-friendly light RPG with a simple and accessible mouse-driven interface. It's more akin to Zelda than Pool of Radiance. There's more of an emphasis on solving quests and simple real-time combat. The movement can feel kind of spastic, but it's more fast and responsive than in previous games like it. Although there are no classes, you can try to sneak past enemies, and you can cast spells by using magic shards. The game takes place in an Arabian Nights-inspired desert setting, with a lot of cliches and humorous writing. There's no character creation, but at least you can choose between whether you want your character to be rude, nice, or neutral when interacting with NPCs. Slayer is a 3DO exclusive action RPG that tried to combine D&D with the action of first-person shooters. At the start of the game, you create a character in accordance to the 2nd edition AD&D rules. After that, you choose how hard the dungeon is going to be and start exploring it. It's downhill from there. It's your average real-time dungeon crawler, where you aimlessly explore maze-like levels, collect loot, open doors, and try to keep yourself fed. To my knowledge, there isn't any story or point to the game beyond advancing to the next level. But then again, I've never been able to play it for more than 15 minutes at a time. The first-person view combat is just god-awful thanks to the poor hit detection, lack of sidestepping, and overzealous turn buttons that make navigating the dungeon a pain even outside of combat. The short draw distance and music helps to build some atmosphere, but the gameplay is dull beyond redemption. The most interesting part of the game is the multi-layered level design that reminds me of early FPS games, even though actual gameplay takes place on a flat plane. DeathKeep was released a year later, this time also for Windows. I've never played it, but I've read that it's even worse than Slayer. Thankfully, not everything released post-92 was half-assed action RPG dreck. Dark Sun Shattered Lands shone the light of turn-based combat and skill checks during the dark age of CRPGs. I've got a full-fledged review of this game on my channel, so if you want a more in-depth summary, check out the description for a link. Dark Sun was released in 1993, and it feels like the next generation version of Pool of Radiance, and for all intents and purposes, the engine was meant to be the successor for Goldbox. Obviously, the graphics and sound were updated, but the interface was also changed to be more accessible. The entire game uses an Ultima 7 style top-down perspective, so there's no more first-person dungeon crawling nor need to map the game by hand. The interface is mouse-driven, which makes it easier to learn and faster to use, while the battle system retains the depth of the Goldbox series. You could use the game as an early example of a sequel that's more pretty and streamlined. Party size was shrunk down to 4, and some features that were present in the Goldbox games have been removed, such as banks. But the gameplay is as tactical and enjoyable as ever, perhaps even more so thanks to the more efficient interface and sound effects that accompany your every attack. Dark Sun was an important step in the evolution of D&D games, as it was the first to ditch grid-based movement in combat. As you can move around and aim your spells in combat more freely, the game feels more modern than its contemporaries. For that reason, I consider it very neglected by game historians and writers, as it played an important evolutionary role in transforming CRPGs from one form to another. While Ultima 7 and Darklands were more foundational for isometric RPGs, Dark Sun was one of the first to provide smooth tactical combat from an isometric perspective. It's also a very good RPG in general. Out of all the early D&D games, it's the one I've enjoyed playing the most. The graphics are beautiful, the combat is easy to learn but tactically involving, and the hostile desert setting is a breath of fresh air. The game is also non-linear and features multiple solutions to some quests, which also helps to make it feel like the missing link between dungeon crawlers and games like Fallout. A year later, it got a sequel called Wake of the Ravager, which even had voice acting.
Hurry! You must come with me to the Veiled Alliance! An evil has crept into Tyr which will destroy us all! I have seen it!
In my original review, I wondered why Dark Sun isn't more well known. Well, since then, both of these games were re-released on GOG, so hopefully this miniseries will start to gain more recognition. I haven't tried the GOG versions, so I can't tell if these bugs have been fixed, but if you plan to try either of these titles in DOSBox, you might have to increase your cycles to circumvent sluggish mouse emulation. Wake of the Ravager also has a bug that makes the songs loop, which you can only get rid of by downloading an old patch, which, thankfully, can still be found online from a German site. Finally, there's an MMO called Dark Sun Online, which was released in 1996, a year before Ultima Online. Naturally, you can't play it online anymore, so I can't really tell you anything about it besides regurgitating things I've read from this Game Sutra postmortem and Game Archaeologist article. I'm fascinated to hear stories about this game, so if you've ever played the game or know someone who did, please share your stories in the comments section. While the D&D license obviously lends itself best for RPGs, various other genres tried adapting the IP in hopes of making some money from brand recognition, like the god-awful fighting game Iron and Blood, Warriors of Ravenloft, which is one of the worst fighting games released for the PS1. Thankfully, all brawlers weren't as bad, as before that, Capcom developed two excellent arcade beat-em-ups using the D&D license, called Tower of Doom and Shadow Over Mystara, which were later compiled together as the Dungeons & Dragons collection for the Sega Saturn in Japan, and more recently received the spiritual successor Dragon's Crown, though that did not have the D&D license. We'll be taking a look at Shadow Over Mystara, which came out later and added more playable classes. The game starts with character selection, with each character representing a different class. Like in Order of the Griffon, dwarves and elves count as their own separate class. The elf is a nimble melee fighter who can cast spells, while the stout dwarf wields an axe and a shield. Warrior is the most self-explanatory class. Thief can pick enemy pockets, double and wall jump, pick locks, detect traps, and has a sling with unending ammunition. Cleric can buff and heal himself, and the magic user can cast various spells. The classes also differ from each other physically, Some are faster, while others are slower. Warriors have the most health, while mages have the least. And mages and thieves can't wear shields nor armor. All classes have their own unique melee attacks they can perform by doing button combinations. And they all have their own unique area of effect attack, which drains a little bit of health, which is a common mechanic in beat-em-ups. What really set these games apart from other side-scrolling beat-em-ups is the extensive amount of items available. There's one button that's dedicated to scrolling through your spells and items. Some classes can also use a shield to block attacks, and there are consumables that you can shoot or throw at your enemies, like fire bottles, throwing axes, wands that cast spells, and a bow which you can shoot. In between levels, you can replenish your stock by buying more weapons. If you find materials from levels, they can be crafted into special items. There are also stat-boosting magical items and gear with magical properties that you can equip by looting them, such as boots of levitation and various rings which offer protection against certain elements, cast spells, and can summon a familiar. Helmets, robes, and armor reduce your AC. Shields with special properties can block fire, ice, dark, and dragon breath attacks. Magic scrolls unlock higher level spells. Potions give temporary boosts, and numerous high level weapons are more powerful than your starting weapons. Another unique aspect is that there's a lot of text for an arcade game. You can even name your characters, and every now and then, the levels branch. Characters also level up, which is only fitting given the D&D theme. All in all, there's a lot of RPG elements in this game. The hack and slash combat might upset some purists, but since it's an arcade game made by a Japanese developer, I don't see this game as a threat to the integrity of D&D games. As a beat-em-up, it's really good, and actually a fairly good representation of core mechanics in an arcade context. I think that it's a far more insidious threat to the purity of RPGs when games that present themselves as such try to cater to action gamers. This is a beat-em-up with action RPG elements, rather than an action RPG with beat-em-up elements, which separates it from Diablo clones and games like Bastion. The Saturn port retains the beautiful backgrounds and smooth animations of the arcade games, but only two players can play co-op, whereas four players could play in the arcade version. That's a bit questionable as the game requires the 4 MB RAM expansion card, even though beat-em-ups that ran on the unexpanded Saturn could support even 6 players at once. The load times are also quite bad, though they never approached Neo Geo CD levels. Even then, it's a minor gripe in an otherwise excellent and visually pleasing game that's just tailor-made for couch co-op. Before we move to the next big chapter in the history of D&D games, there are still a handful of strategy games we need to take a quick look at. During this time period, something important happened, as between 95 and 96 the D&D rights went from SSI to Interplay. Well, the last game in this chapter was released by Sierra, who had secured the rights to an obscure setting called Birthright. First up, there's Spelljammer, Pirates of the Realm Space, one of the most exotic D&D games ever made. Unfortunately, I've never been able to get the game to work because the copyright protection won't let me play, even when I use the correct password. It's a shame, as from the outset, Spelljammer sounds really interesting. It takes place in a space setting, where the player character ends up from a regular medieval D&D world through happenstance. Wikipedia classified this as a mix of tactical RPG, strategy, and adventure, and it uses the Goldbox engine for combat. One interesting detail about the strange Spelljammer setting is that it features a race of creatures called giant space hamsters. Later, the Baldur's Gate series featured a rather famous character called Mintz, who believes that his pet hamster is a miniature giant space hamster. Fantasy Empires was developed by Silicon Knights of Eternal Darkness fame. And from what little I've played, it looks like a solid, Master of Magic-esque turn-based strategy with decent gameplay and good animations. You start the game by making a character in classic D&D fashion, but instead of dungeon crawling, you'll spend your time developing an army, conquering lands, and making treaties with your rivals. Apparently, if you break said treaties, that can change your alignment. Stronghold combined the city-building genre with D&D, while Blood and Magic was the first real-time strategy game to use the D&D license. Though the untrained eye can't notice the fact, especially in Blood and Magic, the D&D influence is negligible. Compared to newer RTS games, the pace is far slower. Not only is the action slow, but gaining mana and building things also takes time and must be manually transferred to a blood forge. With it, you can create more golems, which can transform into different buildings and fighting units. The game world is divided into grids, with each different surface type giving bonuses and penalties for attack, defense, and movement. Birthright, the Gorgon's Alliance, is a turn-based strategy game with a tactical battle component. You can play the full game, which plays like a grand strategy game, or you can do adventure scenarios, where you set up a party of four and engage either in real-time or turn-based battles, which are both equally sloppy.
My liege? My liege? My liege?
Yes, Regent.
Larger-scale strategy where you control an entire kingdom and tinker around with taxes and a million other things that you've got to keep in check isn't really my area of expertise, so I can't comment on whether or not Birthright succeeds as a 4X game, especially after only trying it once without reading the manual. At least I can say the engine wasn't optimized for turn-based squad tactics. BioWare's Baldur's Gate is one of the most important titles in the history of Western RPGs. During the mid-90s, computer RPGs were in a slump. During that time period, Computer Gaming World even refused to give an annual Best RPG award one year due to lack of viable options. While a few notable titles, such as Daggerfall and Realms of Arcania, were released during those years, some predicted the death of the whole genre. Then Diablo came along and reinvigorated the action RPG genre, which arguably had caused this decline of the genre in the first place. 2 years later, Baldur's Gate was released, and it had a similar effect on traditional RPGs. It sold over 2 million units, which was and still is a considerable amount for a CRPG. Not bad for a first effort from an inexperienced team of 60, where only two members had previously even shipped a game. How did a developer that had only one game under its belt even acquire the rights to make a D&D game? They didn't. Their publisher, Interplay, had purchased the rights for using the Forgotten Realm and Planescape settings earlier. Interplay's first D&D game was called Descent to Undermountain, which got its name from using the same engine as the Descent series. Meanwhile, designers at BioWare discarded their idea of developing an MMO called Battleground Infinity, and started converting it to a single-player RPG in the Forgotten Realms setting. Descent to Undermountain ended up being a colossal flop, while Baldur's Gate unexpectedly became the breadwinner out of the two, and thus its Infinity engine ended up being used in all future RPGs developed by a division at Interplay called Black Isle Studios, whose key members founded Obsidian Entertainment after being laid off from Interplay in December of 2003. All in all, there were 5 games which used the Baldur's Gate engine. They're commonly referred to as the Infinity Engine games. That list includes Baldur's Gate 1 and 2 and 2 expansions, Planescape Torment and Icewind Dale 1 and 2, which also received 2 expansions. Out of that group, both Planescape Torment and Baldur's Gate 2 are often considered to be the best computer RPGs of all time, so you could say that the legacy of the engine overshadows the actual game. While it has its devotees, the first title isn't actually as interesting as the succeeding games, so I'm going to divide this section of the video into 3 parts. First, I'll talk about the common characteristics of the Infinity Engine games and the Baldur's Gate series, with a larger emphasis on the second game, as most of my footage is from it. The second part will cover Planescape Torment, and the third, the Icewind Dale series. The defining feature of Infinity Engine games is possible real-time combat. While Darklands was the first game to implement this style of combat, Baldur's Gate popularized it and was the first game to adopt D&D rules to such a system. You control an entire party of characters in real time, but you can pause the action at any point you want by pressing the space bar. This way, you can change your commands at a moment's notice and adapt your strategy on the fly. In theory, this system combines the best aspects of both turn-based and real-time combat, as it removes unnecessary waiting while maintaining the tactical depth present in turn-based games, where you control multiple characters at once. While it superficially resembles an RTS game, under the hood the combat still functions with the same logic that the turn-based tabletop game uses. Every 6 seconds count as a round, and one turn consists of 10 rounds, thus spell durations are in turns and rounds, while damage values are counted with dice rolls that the computer automatically performs. For example, a fireball spell deals 1d6 damage per caster level up to 10d6, meaning that at first it deals the damage you get from rolling a 6-sided dice, while at high levels, it counts together the rolls of 10 6-sided dice. So the combat isn't deterministic, as your spell's damage output can range anywhere from 10 to 60 depending on your luck. This goes for every single attack you make and receive, though there are a lot of modifiers that can add or detract from those numbers, such as race-specific spell resistances, +1 weapons, buffs and debuffs. It might seem like an odd choice for a game that's as relatively modern as Baldur's Gate to be based on hidden dice rolls, but you've got to keep in mind that every single spell, monster, ability, and item that was lifted from the pen and paper game was balanced around the probabilities of a dice roll. Implementing a new system for their video game adaptation would have forced developers to reinvent the wheel. As the game is played from an isometric perspective, positioning and spatial awareness play a key role in combat. You have to keep your caster away from the front lines and be mindful of enemy spells and arrows. Try to estimate the reach of your area of effect spell so you don't accidentally harm your own party members, and move in closer to heal the injured and cast offensive spells that have a limited range. So the battles are very reminiscent of Pool of Radiance, only difference being the tilted camera angle and the fact that they occur in real time. The combat system is very tactical thanks to all the numerous mechanics picked up from the pen and paper RPG. For instance, you can switch between different weapon loadouts during combat, so if your warrior gets rooted by a spell, he can switch to a bow and start shooting enemies. Or if you want a more D&D specific example, skeletons are resistant to slashing and piercing damage, so you should switch to a blunt weapon while fighting them. Trolls are another interesting enemy type, since they regenerate health. So unless you pour acid or fire on them after their health drops to zero, they'll get up again. You can equip a healer or a spellcaster that can use bows with acid or fire arrows, and have them kill a downed troll from a distance while the melee fighters move on to attack the next target. Overall, the amount of variation in encounters is impressive. After all, the developers had an extensive beastry to call upon. There are numerous supplementary D&D books that are dedicated to listing different monsters and their properties. In comparison, many other RPGs are content with recycling the same enemy types over and over again.
Hey, we were pretty pumped about the Burning Crusade. You know, you just got lots of new monsters. Okay, well, they're new skins of old monsters, whatever.
There are over 300 spells at your disposal, twice the amount of Skyrim. Various protective and counter spells bloat the list. For example, you can cast Zone of Sweet Air to dispel harmful spells that linger in the air, such as Stinking Cloud and Cloud Kill. Even beyond counter spells like that, you can use spells defensively, like casting an acid arrow as a quick way to interrupt a spellcasting enemy. In D&D games, especially early level mages aren't as much ranged damage dealers as characters whose jobs it is to disrupt enemies and make survival easier in group versus group combat. For some reason, the game doesn't visually highlight the area of effect for spells, so casters also have to be cautious to avoid friendly fire. While the spell list is impressive, it isn't fully utilized due to the way spell memorization works. I must question the validity of this mechanic in a video game context, as all it does is hinder your ability to react to tough encounters on the fly, as it's a safer bet to fill your slots with spells that work in most situations, rather than situation-specific counterspells and buffs that are rarely necessary. But this is a problem that persists in all faithful D&D video game adaptations. To point out something positive in turn, there's one cool detail about spellcasting that's specific to Baldur's Gate. Each spell school has its own Latin incantation that the caster recites before casting.
Incurtus.
Peter Mortis.
Can I be of most use?
Urtus. Digestion.
Alia.
Latu. Rada.
The gameplay also has little touches like that, which help to increase the game world's verisimilitude outside of combat. Even if many of said features were already implemented in earlier CRPGs like Pool of Radiance and Ultima. For example, your characters have to regularly sleep.
I demand that we stop. The day was not this long even when I led soldiers in the Order.
And where you sleep affects your chances of getting ambushed if you're inside a dungeon.
How can I help?
I am skilled. I shall go forth at your command. Point the sword, and I...
Ready? Oh, yes!
Time passes from night to day as you sleep, travel to new areas, and even if you spend too much time in one place. Weather effects and ambient sounds like birds chirping also help to bring the world to life in a way that earlier games never managed to do, but that's a natural part of technological progression. Carrying too many heavy items slows down and eventually encumbers your character, and how much they can carry scales based on their strength. You can attack anyone you want, including your party members, but killing innocents might adversely affect your reputation, or make your paladin lose his class.
What is your will?
Feel my sting.
Ready, of course.
I'm listening.
All right, very well.
What's up? Fine by me.
Huh?
You also can't move items from one character's inventory to another if the characters are standing too far apart from each other.
Mm-hmm. As you will.
Something you need.
Of course!
Rogues can also perform actions like hiding in shadows, stealing from people, picking locks, detecting and disarming traps. When combined with the ease of party splitting that the mouse-driven UI allows, you can create the kind of gameplay moments that totally should be commonplace in adventurous RPG games, but really aren't. Like you can send your lone rogue to burglarize a house while your lawful paladin obliviously waits outside. Or you can use a quick character to lure an enemy group into an ambush. There was party splitting in previous RPGs, like the Magic Candle and Realms of Arcania series, but the Infinity Engine made it really easy to multitask and send one or more characters into an opposite direction. Another form of party management that adds a bit more depth to the game is the ability to talk to NPCs with different characters, which might yield different results based on their sex, charisma, and race.
Just name what you want.
Hello!
I'm ready for always willing to try.
Your party members also react to the choices you make, and they might leave you permanently if you do something that they don't like based on their personality and alignment.
This isn't right.
I will not tolerate actions such as this. We should strive to be just and fair.
Good and evil characters will also start to bicker and even kill each other if mixed in the same party, so that's something to keep in mind. Speaking of party members, there's another defining feature of the series. Before Baldur's Gate, most Western RPGs featured full party creation. Character drama and inner turmoils of your party members usually did not play any part in the stories, which focused more on external threats. There were RPGs with pre-made characters with written personalities that you could recruit along the way, like in JRPGs, but games like that were in the minority. Baldur's Gate started the trend of Western RPGs involving the player character in the story on a more personal level, while still retaining some level of control in the player's hand in the form of a blank slate protagonist. In fact, the character creation is deeper than in any previous D&D game, as it features weapon specialization, choosing starting spells, and a more extensive list of classes, most of which were given 3 subclasses in the sequel. Subclasses, or kits as they're called here, grant certain abilities and bonuses with some negative caveat. Oh, and stat allocation finally replaced dice rolling, though you can still randomize your stats if you want to. But no matter what race, gender, class, or alignment you choose, your character's backstory remains the same. Thus, from 2000 onwards, Western big-budget RPGs started placing more emphasis on story and characters at the cost of party creation and combat system. But like transformative trendsetters tend to do, Baldur's Gate still has its other foot firmly rooted in tradition. Examples of such mechanics could include identifying items, which many consider a tedious process, and the ability to ignore and leave central characters out of your party. There are so many recruitable party members with their own side quests and backstories that you can't experience everything in just one playthrough, and you still do have the option for creating a custom party. It's just not the intended way to play through the game, as game balance and story were crafted with the pre-made characters in mind. Baldur's Gate 2 is known for its colorful yet believably written and flawed characters, which you can even have romances with, which became the hallmark of BioWare games.
Ride the bull.
Again, BioWare wasn't the first to include romance options in an RPG, but they popularized the idea.
That actually summarizes Baldur's Gate 2 well. It's not the most innovative game,
but rather one that polished good ideas of previous RPGs into a memorable and well-executed package. It's the quintessential D&D game, which is the reason why it's often considered to be the best Western RPG ever made. It doesn't have any major flaws, and it's competent in everything it does. It hasn't got the best combat, character progression, or story and writing, but it's good in all these categories. That doesn't sound like a growing compliment, but the fact is that CRPGs are such a complex and ambitious genre that most of the highly revered fan favorites have big flaws or deficiencies due to the realities of game development. Many CRPGs excel in some aspects while being underdeveloped in others. Often, if the writing is good, the gameplay is subpar, or vice versa. Technical difficulties and bugs are also common in non-linear and reactive sandboxes. But Baldur's Gate 2 has everything. A good story with memorable characters, a tactical combat system, and diverse encounter design. Satisfying character development and party management, non-linear structure and replayability, lengthy campaigns with tons of quests and content, beautiful pre-rendered backgrounds, efficient and user-friendly interface, and good voice acting and sound design. While various other games surpass it within all of these categories, it's hard to think of another pure-blooded CRPG that is as good a total package as Baldur's Gate 2 is. Of course, that doesn't mean it's flawless, or that everyone is guaranteed to like it. While the interface is great and easy to learn, it could be improved. It takes too long for spell tooltips to load, and you can't right-click an item you're about to loot to check out its description and stats. It also wouldn't hurt if adding hotkeys was a quicker process, though you can manage just fine using your mouse and space button. Another common gripe is the fact that you must gather your party before you can exit a zone, which leads to unnecessary waiting at times.
You must gather your party before venturing forth. You must gather your party before venturing forth. You must gather your party before venturing forth.
I await high ambition.
You must gather your party before venturing forth.
I can hear I left all this noise and crowds for very good reasons.
Though it's understandable why such a feature was implemented, as otherwise you could run away from some encounters too easily. I suspect that that was the developer's intention. However, it's the real-time with pause combat system that people tend to disagree with the most. While it is one of the better examples of using such a system in an RPG, and the combat is still way above the standard of newer BioWare and Obsidian games, real-time with pause still has its problems. Some of them inherent, while others are caused by D&D rules and programming. Pathfinding issues can be really annoying, and the AI is more brain-dead than in turn-based games.
Yeah, sure.
And because the combat mechanics are based on invisible hidden turns, rolls, and timers, that can mess with you. Like when trying to cast a heal spell, the seamless nature of real-time combat makes it unpredictable and chaotic, and you often have to constantly pause and repause the game to reissue orders as you react to the behavior of your enemies. Suffice it to say that many CRPG fans tend to dislike real-time with pause combat for things like that. While I personally prefer turn-based, I still enjoy combat in Infinity Engine games.
There's one Infinity Engine feature that's worth a mention before we look at Planescape Torment, since it's kind of its expertise. The itemization is great, as there are a lot of unique weapons and items with their own backstories. When you inspect an item to see its properties, you can often read about the history of the more powerful and unique weapons. If you don't pay attention, you might equip a cursed, unremovable magic belt which changes your character's gender. Some weapons also have unique chance on-hit effects and other magic qualities, which sometimes can make them more valuable than nominally more powerful weapons, at least in certain situations.
Having stuff like that makes you think carefully about what weapon to use in which encounter and how to develop your character and party is something that adds a lot of depth and enjoyment to any RPG. I feel the opposite in Pillars of Eternity, which is the spiritual successor of Infinity Engine games. Getting loot wasn't satisfying, at least on low levels, as every item was balanced in such a banal way that getting new gear felt meaningless. You can see the same phenomenon in World of Warcraft. In the Halcyon days of Vanilla, many epic and even various rare items had wild chance on hit effects, or were otherwise creative and unique. Some of them were extremely powerful when used in tandem with some other item, or they offered great benefit situationally while being weaker than more standard weapons. In the expansion packs, the developers started placing more and more emphasis on game balance, and as a result, the itemization became really homogeneous. Every single item felt like they were balanced on some Excel function, following a strict formula, which boiled the player's choice down to, do I want the sword of 4 strength and 8 stamina, or 8 strength and 4 stamina? That really sucked the fun out of getting new items, and made everything feel more disposable and samey, which coincided with loot getting easier to obtain, and memorable designs becoming rarer. Early World of Warcraft, or older RPGs in general, were balanced, but that's what makes them fun. If you don't know what you're doing, you might create a character that's very unoptimal, if not practically unplayable. But on the other hand, smart players who understand the mechanics are rewarded for cleverly exploiting the system. Anyhow, let's move on to the next game, without getting further sidetracked.
If there's one game in this video that everyone should play, regardless of how you personally feel about D&D or CRPGs at large, it's Planescape Torment. It has a very unique setting, and it's often regarded as one of the most well-written games of all time. It not only transcends the D&D license, but the entire genre itself. Saying that the storyline is amazing would still be selling the game short. The writing is just so much better, even when compared with most of competently written and highly praised video game narratives. But because the story is so integral to the experience, I had to restrain myself from writing a larger appraisal, because I don't want to spoil anything important. I should also point out that I captured the footage using a widescreen patch, so the areas look way more zoomed out than intended, and you'll see the Bandicam icon flashing periodically due to some compatibility issues that I couldn't get fixed. With that out of the way, I guess the best place to start is by giving a synopsis of the story. You play as an immortal amnesiac, commonly referred to as the Nameless One. He wakes up from a mortuary, with his memory lost and skin filled with scars and tattoos that urge him to find a man named Farad. The main character doesn't even know his name. It's the player's job to find out how he became immortal and how you can undo the process. The Nameless One loses his memory every time he dies. The story features philosophical undertones, and it centers around the question,
what can change the nature of a man?
Over the course of the game, you come across people and events that were affected and shaped by your past incarnations. Some of them were evil, others good, some stark raving mad. Some of them were men of great importance, others might have died in a ditch only days after being resurrected. That concept of multiple past personalities fits in well mechanically, as it's a role-playing game that allows you to roleplay as an evil character if you don't want to be a polite goody-two-shoes, or even a neutral pragmatist. Having untold past incarnations leave their mark on the city makes for some really fascinating story moments. For example, at one point you'll find an important item that belongs to you, only to find out that it's locked by a mechanism written in some obscure language. No one knows what it says, so you'll have to find a linguist, who tells you that his dead father was the only remaining person who knew that language. Turns out your past incarnation killed him, presumably to protect the secrets of that item. Your character isn't called the Nameless One only because he's an amnesiac. Many of his past selves protected their identity by avoiding names altogether, so that it'd be harder to trace back events to them. It's moments like that which really turn this into an unforgettable gaming experience. Interesting and mind-blowing twists are numerous, and it's easy to stay invested in the storyline, as it's a personal tale, rather than a trite plot about saving the entire world. The story of the Nameless One is only a part of what makes this story so exceptional. The game world is incredibly unique, and full of exotic races, competing factions, and manifestations of different metaphysical concepts, so the Nameless One's story is only one amongst hundreds of others. Whatever preconceived notions you have of fantasy, forget about them. There are no dwarves, orcs, or elves to be found in this game. The game world is inhabited by races like Modrons, Tanari, Abishai, and Githzerai. Writer Chris Avalon intentionally set out to subvert age-old tropes and tired RPG cliches, but to his credit, the game doesn't feel like a pretentious deconstruction of the genre or anything like that. It's just a very densely written and original RPG that takes place in a strange world filled with bizarre creatures. You can spend hours reading up on different races, factions, events, and just chatting with people. There's even a university where you can listen to lectures. Somehow, the writers managed to make attending a class a more engaging task than most action-packed set-piece moments in AAA games. That's all thanks to the perfect blend of interesting fantasy setting and sharp writing that makes high fantasy relatable through a mix of dialogue that makes characters multifaceted and believable and a story that tackles moral and existential issues and philosophical concepts. Torment mostly takes place in a city called Sigil, which sits on top of an infinitely tall spire at the center of the multiverse. It's connected to various other planes by an endless amount of portals that can be anything and activated in all kinds of ways, which is an idea that was seen a year later in Harry Potter. As the city is a central hub, it's filled with all kinds of different races as we've already established. There are also 5 joinable factions, which all have their central beliefs and core values. Usually games that feature factions force you to pick a side. It's all optional here, but getting to know what different groups believe is still interesting. Some of the things they say hold relevance even in our modern world, where many are in search of an all-encompassing life philosophy to bring guidance to their lives and reduce existential angst. Like I've said in another video, this game starts by giving a really grotesque and even a horror-like vibe, but that visceral shock turns into a very cerebral experience as you start seeing below the surface and uncovering the philosophical undertones of the story. And it's not just the philosophical dialogue that makes the experience mentally stimulating. The game just presents some interesting and abstract ideas. Like there's a town plunged into chaos when its alignment shifts from neutral to chaotic evil as a result of its inhabitants' behavior, as faith is such a powerful thing that even gods can die when people stop believing in them. Much like the protagonist, Planescape Torment, as a whole, is a great example of great beauty existing within a menacing and ugly shell. Not that I'm saying that the graphics are bad, just that the first areas are really grim and filthy. Like said, the game starts from a mortuary that's filled with zombies and corpses that have been sliced open, which are just rotting on tables and being used to harvest organs, blood, and skin. Once you stumble outside, you find yourself in a really rough part of town that's just filled with rude people who'll tell you to get bent if you ask for help. Gang members who'll kill you for a dime, hookers, loud drunks, insane homeless people, and filthy beggars. There's a death-worshipping cult whose members make a living by gathering up and disposing of the corpses that pile up in the dirty streets. The sound design really helps drive across the point of what a filthy and unwelcoming place this part of Sigil is, as the sound of drunks, aggressive merchants, and yelling are all part of the ambient soundscape.
Come on in here, Cutter, give it a rest! You don't want to sleep on the street, you get killed out here!
Alright.
Good as done.
Baldur's Gate had a more rich sound than previous RPGs, which had mostly relied on music to enhance the mood and nothing else, but the use of ambient sounds is even more effective here.
Alright, alright. Alright.
On my first playthrough, I was actually intimidated by this place. In the middle portion of your journey, when you gain access to the more affluent districts, it feels like a relief to be surrounded by people who bathe regularly, who won't steal your valuables, or shove a knife up your spine the moment you turn your back. NPCs of higher social standing dress better and talk in a more civilized manner, while the gutter trash talk in a colloquial dialect that reflects their rough upbringing and coarse manners. They even made up words and specific insults like jink, cutter, and burk. It's attention to detail like that what separates developers who understand their craft from the overwhelming majority who don't really think things through. Right. Speaking of NPCs, there's a ton of them in this game. Copy-pasted stock characters are few and far between, as almost every single inconsequential character has their unique description and dialogue. Thankfully, you can hover over NPCs to see their name, so you can easily tell who might have something useful to say. Descriptive writing is something that separates Torment and other isometric RPGs of this era from modern ones. The writers spare no adjectives when describing to the player what the environment and characters around you are like. Their sprites might not look any different when viewed through an isometric perspective, but once you engage in conversation, you'll immediately know what kind of person you're talking to. Torment in particular is very verbose. Its script has more than 800,000 words in it, which is more than the combined word count of The Hobbit, Lord of the Rings, and Silmarillion, or the first six Harry Potter books. What makes that even more impressive is the fact that there are very few typos and the writing is stellar across the board, rather than sporadically. While the high word count is bloated by plentiful dialogue options, branching conversations, and tons of optional content, there's no denying that you do a lot of reading in this game. But it rarely feels like the developers were intentionally making the conversations wordy, nor does the amount of text feel overwhelming. The high word count is a byproduct of great writing, but there's no intrinsic value in making the player spend 5 minutes to read one conversation. Plus, the writers felt confident enough in their abilities that they never force you to sit through unskippable cutscenes or conversations. If you wish to do so, you can just spam buttons and get over conversations without reading a word. To be honest, I felt trepidation coming back to this title after playing Pillars of Eternity and completely ignoring many of its walls of text. The sole description seemed utterly pointless. I hold this game in very high regard, so I was kind of scared of the perspective that I might have been more patient and thorough with its dialogue on my first playthrough simply because it's one of the first RPGs I ever played. I'm glad to say that I really enjoyed replaying it for this video. I almost have a newfound admiration for the writing, now that some of the twists and interesting events I had forgotten about are fresh in my mind. And even though I saw new things during my second playthrough, there are still things that I haven't seen or tried. But enough about the story already. Let's talk about gameplay. The game gets flack for subpar gameplay, and I partially agree with that. But at its core, it's still an Infinity Engine game, which makes it better than most RPGs, even when combat is the least polished part of the design.
What is thy bidding?
Being able to devise strategies like kiting enemy groups into a powerful call lightning spell still beats mindless click fests and flaccid gunplay. The combat is similar as in Baldur's Gate, though encounter design is more lazy and unvaried. There are some new mechanics, like racial combat skills such as taunting an enemy. Some of the high-level spells with intricate over-the-top animations have taken a page out of Final Fantasy's book. The reworked UI is kind of slow and cumbersome to use, and an overall unneeded addition. The combat-to-story ratio is way more unbalanced than in Baldur's Gate. You can actually run past most encounters, as only one character has to reach a door for the whole party to be teleported to the next area. Plus, smart and charismatic characters can often talk their way out of trouble in some boss fights. While there are optional dungeons, I'd say that about 80% of the game is just dialogue. As good as the writing is, the way some quests are framed can get a bit trite, as you'll have to do a lot of back and forth running between people and items. The character development aspect was hit the hardest. Due to the JRPG-ish nature of the game, you don't have much meaningful input when it comes to developing your party. There are only 4 classes to choose for your character. Everyone starts out as a warrior, and if they want to become a thief, priest, or spellcaster, you must do additional quests and become trained in those professions. There are more skill checks for intelligence, wisdom, and charisma than strength and agility, so that's another limiting factor in character development. At least you can find and buy many interesting items and weapons for your party members to equip. Most notably, humanoid characters have tattoo slots, where you can equip stat-boosting tattoos that act like armor. Oddly enough, they aren't permanent, so they can be removed and re-equipped as you see fit. There are a few new unique mechanics that fit in well thematically, like the shifting alignment system, which is Planescape Torment's largest mechanical contribution to the RPG genre. Over the course of the game, your options and behavior shape your character's alignment from true neutral to different shades of good and evil, whereas in most D&D games, your alignment is static. There are even items that require certain alignments in order to be equipped or used, like a permanent constitution boost of 1, so there's a mechanical impetus for players to use this system to their advantage. As your player character is immortal, you sometimes might have to die to accomplish certain goals. It also makes the game easier, so this is a good place to start if you're new to CRPGs. Even if you have no interest in the genre, this is one game every video game connoisseur and advocate of the games are art movement must play. Thanks to the slick pre-rendered backgrounds that are complemented by some animated details and a creative art style, the visuals have aged well and look, in fact, better than many 3D RPGs that were released in the early 2000s. Long as you read the journal, pay attention to dialogue, realize that you don't have to win every fight, and keep in mind that the lower your armor rating, the better, you should be fine. Long as you use common sense, don't expect the game to guide you from start to finish. Learn from your mistakes, and adapt your playstyle to old convention. You should be able to enjoy older titles like Planescape Torment with relative ease. Icewind Dale was the final chapter in the saga of Infinity Engine games. If Baldur's Gate stands in the middle ground, and Torment is heavily skewed towards story, Icewind Dale provides the yin to its yang by being the most combat-oriented series out of the bunch. Compared to Baldur's Gate, it features less side quests and more linear progression from town to dungeon. Since town layouts are more simple and there aren't as many places to go, the experience is less overwhelming for those who've never played an RPG like this where you must follow your journey and pay attention to dialogue instead of following a quest arrow. However, the combat might provide too big a challenge for beginners, as this game's main target audience is fans of Baldur's Gate and other CRPG fans who like to min-max their party. While the story isn't as prominent, some prefer the more restrained tone of Black Isle writing over BioWare's quirkiness. A welcome addition was the inclusion of full party creation. Unlike in Torment, you have to make your own party from scratch at the start of the new game. Though you don't have to make a full party, you can try to solo the game with just one character if you want to. While the party creation is not at Wizardry's level when it comes to options, it's still very enjoyable to ponder what kind of composition of races and classes you'll use on your playthrough. You can choose your character's portrait and voice, though the voice options are kind of lacking.
Elken Ulu Dathir, steal yourselves! Attack!
Well, looks like I'm gonna have to go on a killing spree.
I am indomitable!
Today is a good day to die.
The Silent Blade cuts best.
I'll take care of it.
There's something to be said for playing a game with a group of characters you made yourself. It's a trade-off between being in control of your own journey and more intricate writing that games like Torment and The Witcher offer. I've personally found the joy that seeing a party of my choosing prosper brings to me is greater than the benefits of pre-made party members, at least most of the time. Even though your characters don't talk or have their own personalities in classic CRPGs and dungeon crawlers, I found myself more attached to them than many written characters that are trying to engage me on some emotional level. I assume that's one of the reasons why so many D&D games have alignment systems that are useless. That way players could mentally roleplay their own party dynamic, as systemizing something like that would have been unfeasible. Like the name implies, the game takes place in an Arctic region at the northwestern tip of the fictional subcontinent of Faerun. The beautiful pre-rendered backgrounds really bring this area to life. You can just feel the cold air in your breath while enjoying the frigid atmosphere from the warm comfort of your home. This is one area where Icewind Dale surpasses Baldur's Gate, in my opinion. In no small amount, thanks to the soundtrack by Jeremy Soule, who later went on to compose the music of Skyrim. The character portraits are also really well drawn. It's a visually pleasing game that feels cozy to play. After expanding the first game with two content packs, Black Isle released a sequel 2 years later, which ended up being the swan song for the Infinity Engine. The most notable change was the move from 2nd edition of the D&D rules set to the 3rd. Other than that, it treads similar ground as the first game. Since the engine was the most matured at this point, this is where things like background art, combat AI, and encounter design reached its peak. However, the second title is usually considered the weaker offering out of the two. Oh, and one thing that I forgot to mention is that both Icewind Dale and Baldur's Gate games include the option of playing multiplayer. But I've never tried that, so I can't comment on how it works. The game that started it all was rebooted in 2001, when Stormfront Studios put out Pool of Radiance, Ruins of Mythdranor. They had previously worked on Goldbox Games, Neverwinter Nights, and Stronghold, but from 93 onwards, they mostly developed sports games. That might have affected their ability to make good RPGs, as this game is somewhat infamous for being an extreme disappointment for longtime fans. On the outset, it looks nice. It has great visuals and a seemingly feature-rich turn-based battle system. But my game is bugged, so I can't personally tell whether the resentment stems from poor design and gameplay, or just lack of testing and bugs. Either way, you rarely hear anyone talk about this game, and when you do, it's nothing positive. It's a shame, as the game is superficially similar to the Temple of Elemental Evil. Troika's Temple of Elemental Evil is an interesting title. While other Troika games had great writing and original content but uneven quality due to their ambition, Temple of Elemental Evil is the complete opposite. It has very little content for an RPG. The setting and story are as generic as it gets, and there is no interesting characters or dialogue to speak of. But the gameplay is very polished, and the combat system is one of the all-time greats among RPGs. It was designed by the Fallout creator Tim Kaine, so it's no wonder that the mechanics and system design are above average. Another notable aspect of Temple of Elemental Evil is that it is the last major turn-based CRPG that was released before the genre died for about a decade. In the same vein, it was also the last Western RPG to provide players with the freedom of full party creation, as single-character action RPGs and BioWare's JRPG-inspired style of filling the player's party with extensively written pre-made characters became the norm for the genre during the 2000s. Being the last of its kind is a really unfortunate fate, as Temple of Elemental Evil made some notable improvements to the Infinity Engine formula. The turn-based battle system is robust and deep, while the interface made small helpful improvements, such as the ability to choose how long you want to sleep, a camera that automatically pans to an enemy's location if you click its combat icon, and being able to travel on the world map without exiting your current location. D&D players consider it to be the most faithful representation of the tabletop rule set seen in a video game, which is impressive given that the 3.5 edition rule set that it uses was only released a few months prior. But even non-players who don't understand the rules can appreciate this game for its great combat and atmosphere. The game starts with party creation, but this time you have to choose the alignment of your party, which determines how the story begins. After that, you create 5 characters of fitting alignments. The character creation process is more extensive than in Infinity Engine titles, as this time around you can affect things like specific class specialization, height, and religion of your character. There's also an extensive list of feats, many of which have prerequisites for learning, which adds depth to the long-term character planning. Feats can range anywhere from item crafting and passive health and roll bonuses to additional benefits like cleave and increasing the duration or target area of a spell. Although Temple is only known for its combat, it's still worth noting that there are skill checks and dialogue choices, so talking to the same character with a smart and a dumb character yields different dialogue. While in one optional quest, you can choose to take a girl as your slave if you don't want to pay for her freedom and release her. The combat system incorporates a lot of new mechanical bells and whistles, such as differing weapon ranges, flat-footedness, empowered spells and feats, attacks of opportunity, power attack, and movement options such as a 5-foot step in readying against an approaching enemy, spell or defending. The most notable feature which affects how the battles play out is the inclusion of attacks of opportunity. Each player has a visible perimeter around them, and if you run past it, that character automatically performs a free melee strike, even if it isn't their turn. This means that you've got to be careful how you move around the battlefield, and how you position your characters is important. Like in the Goldbox games, you can protect your casters by forming a defensive line in front of them. Each character has a tumble rating, which determines their chances of avoiding an attack of opportunity. You can also perform a 5-foot step to move your vulnerable characters away from nearby enemies without triggering an attack of opportunity. Even though the game is turn-based, it doesn't have random battles. Like in Dark Sun, the game will switch from real-time exploration to turn-based mode if you get near enough an enemy or attack one. After that, turns are divided based on your character's initiative ratings. On top of the screen, you can see a list of all participants in the battle and their turn order. So instead of teams taking turns beating each other up, characters will act individually. Each character has a set amount of energy to use during their turn, which is dependent on their attributes and inventory. The green bar is energy reserved for attacking, while the yellow bar is for movement. Though you can consume your green bar for non-combat actions such as accessing your inventory, stopping an unconscious party member from bleeding to death, or just moving further. While that system is deeper than in your average RPG, it's too binary. Even though there's a lot of nuances to the combat mechanics, the interface is remarkably simple to use, as right-clicking brings up a radial wheel that contains all the different spells and actions you might want to perform. While it takes some time to get used to, it's so simple that you could port this game for consoles, which definitely would not have worked with the Infinity Engine titles. There are also other features like that that make the experience more beginner-friendly and intuitive in comparison, like spellcasting having clear visual indications for the area of effect. Character models are also more detailed and clearly animated, as you can expect from a newer game. Visually, the game is similar with the Infinity Engine games. It uses eye-pleasing pre-rendered backgrounds in tandem with some animated effects such as chimneys that spew smoke. The graphics are good, but the visual design doesn't reach the same artistic heights due to its lack of memorable areas. The soundtrack by Ron Fish makes up for that. It has a very unusual but nonetheless powerful yet relaxing ambient sound. Some of these songs sound more like Blade Runner than Dungeons & Dragons. While the gameplay and atmosphere are top-notch, Temple isn't without its flaws. The pedestrian story can be overlooked, but a more fatal flaw is the lackluster encounter design, which fails to match the high standards of the battle system. The importance of designing good fights with clever AI cannot be overstated in a game like this, because in a single-player game, the combat is as deep and engaging as the encounters are. If most of them consist of copy-pasted goons that you can beat with the most basic of tank and spank strategies, all the depth and complexity of the battle system are for naught. Conversely, a game like Counter-Strike can feel extremely tactical despite the limited amount of ways to interact, simply because you're playing against other people. Of course, the games aren't in any way comparable with each other. But there are many RPGs with way more simplistic encounter design out there, and you can easily get wiped out in a few turns, if you play carelessly and don't think before you act. Some of the bigger skirmishes are very enjoyable, even if they lack challenge and variety. Since the game is based on an actual D&D module, it might be a case of developers copying its encounter design too slavishly in another medium where pre-scripted AI controls monsters instead of dungeon masters who can adapt to player choices. Whatever the case may be, the inadequate encounter design prevents this game from reaching its full potential. There is a mod pack called Circle of Eight that's still being updated. I've never played it, so I can't tell whether it focuses more on adding new content or tweaking the AI and rules to make the combat more tactical. But it's worth noting that the other two tactical RPGs that have a similar dedicated mod site are Jagged Alliance 2 and Final Fantasy Tactics, which both populate the highest echelon of RPG combat systems. If you play the unmodded version, Temple also lacks content. There are two cities, two dungeons, and a few small locations scattered around the world map. It's very short and compact for an RPG, even if said locations are more densely packed with interesting content than your average town or dungeon in a modern sandbox RPG. For a long time, Temple of Elemental Evil was considered to have the best battle system in any CRPG. Nowadays, there's Divinity, Original Sin, that's largely modeled after it, but it uses a more flexible AP system and has interactive environments. So I don't know if you can call Temple a must-play anymore, as much as I like it, but it's still a high watermark for combat when it comes to official D&D video games. Although it's not the next game in a chronological order, Knights of Chalice is a good game to mention at this point. It's an indie game in its true meaning, developed by just one person and sold only at his personal website. The game uses a 3.5 edition rule set like Temple of Elemental Evil, and is similar in its use of feats and character creation. However, there are only a meager 3 classes and races available, plus we're back to rolling dice for stats. If you can look past that, the MS Paint visuals, and elevator music, Knights of Chalice surpasses all preceding games in its implementation of turn-based D&D combat. All the new additions from Temple of Elemental Evil, like 5-foot steps, attacks of opportunity, and empowering spells are here, but there are also new features, such as bull rushing and grappling. The best part is the AI is smart enough to exploit all the intricacies of the battle system. An enemy wizard might throw a fireball to burn away your web spell, while a warrior might bull rush your character that's standing next to an entangled area, pushing him onto the area that's under the influence of that spell. That's what makes the game so challenging and deep. The AI is fiendishly clever. In most games, if you throw a grease puddle or a similar spell next to a choke point, all the enemies will obliviously rush through it. Not only does this game surpass D&D games made by actual developers, it has better AI than most RPGs, period. It's simultaneously impressive and sad if a bedroom production like this can beat the AI in games that have millions to produce. Of course, scripting the AI is a much bigger concern in a combat-focused project like this, but it's still offensive how lazy in comparison so many big-budget games are when it comes to designing combat encounters. While some of the abbreviations might be unfamiliar to first-time players, it's not a hard game to get into once you get the hang of the UI. The control scheme is user-friendly and easy to use, and the game contains an in-game atlas, which you can use to read up on various D&D rules, how spells work, and so on. This is one of the few modern games modeled after retro aesthetics and mechanics that actually surpasses the game it emulates. The developer, Pierre Begu, is currently working on Knights of the Chalice 2, which will increase the class selection from 4 to 22, and, by the looks of it, will have improved graphics and whatnot. So that's something to keep an eye on. Given how overblown in popularity so many indie games are these days, Pierre definitely needs and deserves all the support he can get. Before we move on to the final part of this video, there are a lot of RPGs we need to skim through simply because I haven't got the money and time to buy and play many of these titles. I know that even up to this point, I've covered many games very superficially, as many of them I have never played before. There's two reasons. First of all, this video is meant to be more of an overview of the evolution and gravitas of D&D video games, not a deep mechanical analysis. I just wanted to point out the massive influence of this IP and make it easier for the uninitiated to figure out which of these games are worth playing and which are best left forgotten. It also would have taken an insane amount of time to play through every single D&D game ever made, and covering every one of them in depth would have made this video longer than a Silmarillion movie adaptation by Peter Jackson. I need to get this video out before February, so I had to cut out some games so I could get this video out in time before other obligations and new game releases will eat up all my time. So without further ado, here's a brief summary of the rest of the official D&D game releases of the 21st century. Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance and its sequel are fairly well-received Diablo clones. Dungeons & Dragons Heroes looks like a shallow run-of-the-mill hack and slash. Forgotten Realms Demonstone doesn't seem as uninspired, as at least the story was written by R.A. Salvatore, who's worked on a lot of D&D novels. DragonShard is another D&D-based RTS. D&D Online was released in 2006 and still exists. D&D Tactics is a solid tactical RPG and a welcome change of pace from the hack-and-slash shovelware, but I can't capture footage for PSP games. Daggerdale was another disposable Diablo clone released for Live Arcade, PSN, and Steam. iOS has also got its share of D&D titles in recent years. By the looks of it, Arena of War is a tactics game, while Lords of Waterdeep is a video game conversion of a tabletop strategy game by the same name. Finally, there's Sword Coast Legends, which was only recently released to mediocre reviews. There's one series of games I didn't mention in that list, and that's the 2002 BioWare reboot of Neverwinter Nights and its 2006 sequel, which was developed by Obsidian. These games received a whopping 11 expansion packs over the course of 7 years, so this series is like the modern-day equivalent of Goldbox Games. On top of the official expansions, there are countless user-made campaigns for these games, as the game was supplied with the Aurora toolset that let players craft their own custom modules. When talking about user-created content, Neverwinter Nights is to RPGs what Doom and Half-Life are to FPS games. Sadly, I couldn't capture footage from these games, and my experience with them is limited, as I dislike the camera and combat. So it's better that I don't do a half-assed job of covering such an important series, as much as I'd like this video to be an all-encompassing look at the history of D&D video games. And that wraps it up. I don't play D&D myself, so I couldn't comment on things like how different rule editions and games handled certain gameplay aspects differently and so on. This video is meant to be more of an introduction and summary for the uninitiated. As a fan of game history, I couldn't help noticing how often the subject of D&D is brought up in interviews with notable American game developers. Now, older viewers might take the influence for granted, as D&D played such an integral part to the shaping zeitgeist of Generation X gamers. But for younger gamers, it's not at all obvious how pervading the design tenets of D&D truly are in video games. I haven't got the exact sales numbers to back up my statement, but if you take a look at the last console generation, it's obvious that D&D games fell to the wayside after BioWare and Obsidian offerings like Knights of the Old Republic, Oblivion, Mass Effect, and Fallout 3 steadily increased the market share and mainstream popularity of Western RPGs to new heights. It's all part of the paradigm shift, which coincides with Microsoft's decision to enter the console market, after which previously PC-centric games were appropriated through multi-platform development, which arguably led to stale middle-ground design that neither plays up to the strengths of the PC nor console gaming. However, my intention isn't to make a statement regarding whether or not strictly following pen and paper rules improves the quality of Western RPGs. I just wanted to point out the historic significance of D&D and pay respect to the roots of a genre that now rakes in hundreds of millions of dollars annually. As you've witnessed by now, sometimes those rules can lead to baffling results when applied to another medium. When developers are given free rein to design their RPG systems from the ground up, that can lead to excellent results that surpass some of those stifling conventions. But, on the other hand, 5 decades of playtesting have honed D&D rules to the point where in competent hands they can be applied in a way that outclasses the competition. As for the future D&D games, it's hard to tell where things are heading. The pen and paper sales declined throughout the last decade, but it's too early to tell whether the changes made in the recently released 5th edition will bring more players to the game, or if the player base will continue to dwindle. My personal guess is that these days fewer and fewer young kids are getting into tabletop RPGs and similar hobbies, but I don't want to speculate without any solid data to back up my statements. At least there has been a resurgence of CRPGs within the last 3 years thanks to Kickstarter. Pillars of Eternity is modeled after Baldur's Gate, while the upcoming Tarmin, Tides of Numenera, follows in Planescape Torment's footsteps. Neither of these games uses the D&D rule set, though, but Numenera is based on a pen-and-paper RPG of the same name. While those games are harkening back to the glory days of the Infinity Engine, there are also attempts to make a new game in the style of Pool of Radiance by the newly formed SSI successor Tactics Simulations Interactive. However, the campaign for Seven Dragons Saga failed to make the target goal of $450,000 and was thus cancelled. Baldur's Gate and Icewind Dale got recently remade, and there's even a brand new expansion in the works called Siege of Dragonspear. Finally, GOG.com recently released a bunch of SSI's old games. They've got most of the best games covered by now, and different compilation packs and original jewel case of CD releases aren't hard to come by nor expensive on eBay and similar online auction sites. While not technically legal, various abandonware sites and DOSBox have got you covered when it comes to playing older games that came on floppy disks. Hopefully this video inspired everyone who made it this far to play at least one D&D game you've never played before.
Magic scrolls unlock higher level spells. Potions.
You're watching porn?
No, I'm reading a script.
Jeez, that door should have been locked.